Simpson and Bruckheimer make what are called event movies. Big action, big adventure, a lot of noise. The kind of picture that tends to appeal to American teenage boys, who are the perfect movie-going audience because they'll go back four times, five times, six times. You can meet people who've seen the Beverly Hills Cop movies 15 times.
A Simpson-Bruckheimer movie is a very simple-minded, rather stupid movie that people would have been ashamed to have made 50 years ago, made in the flashiest possible manner with the least possible humanity and compassion, but then makes $100 million.
The Exocet is what took out one of the carriers.
This Exocet missile, and this is where we got the reality, is the one that downed the airliner.
No, this is a ship, air to ship. Takes a ship out, Exorcist. It's going to take their ship out.
And you put your Exocets also fire from ships?
Yes.
Yeah.
There's nobody like those two guys. I mean, people were saying to me, oh, man, you're going to meet those crazy bastards? Oh, man, I mean, you know, somebody said to me, oh, it was a director that had worked with them, came up to me and said, you got a bulletproof vest?
Uh-huh. Right.
Their reputation was that they were control freaks, that they liked taking young directors and actually being able to control as directors and using them to produce their movies, their product. But they are the best in terms of what are called packaging merchants.
Stacy? I also need to know on the development report. Do you have the development report?
They're updating it with the
inserts. Well, I need to know what the status of the boxing movie is. What I want to know is, they had an outline on it. Apparently, they had an approach. They had some kind of a structural approach to it. And I want to read that tomorrow or this weekend when I'm doing it. Also, make sure that I've got all those supplies that we discussed.
They went up to the house yesterday.
Well, I didn't see them there today. I looked.
Okay, I'll ask Susie to lay them out. I'll find out.
You know, so I want to make sure everything's there.
Okay.
Thank you.
The structure of their office is a good indication of a good cop, bad cop routine, because their office is divided up. They both sit at a very long desk, and one sits on one side of the desk, one sits on the other. So you can only focus your attention on one at one moment in time. Yeah. And so whilst you're looking here, talking to Jerry, Don is sitting back there, and he's giving Jerry looks. So they get themselves in sync in terms of what they want to do with you, in terms of how they want to reprogram an argument, yeah.
Let me ask you a question. She gets in her car? Do we ever get out of her car?
Wait a minute.
She gets in her car to leave?
Yeah.
Where does that occur?
In the parking lot.
You know, we probably never use that.
Why?
Well, because what she'll say to Cruz is they'll have the exchange.
I can't watch.
No, but what she
does, you'll never see her get in the car.
So you left on a big close-up. You left. So you can go, we can do what we want with it.
Okay.
And what was good, you think, maybe she does go, maybe she doesn't. Next, you say she's coming back.
Well, what is the next thing we're going to see? You got to see what turns her around.
You hear it.
Okay. Yeah.
The deal was unique in that it promised the two filmmakers a really unprecedented license to make any picture they wanted, with any star, with any director they wanted, from any script, without having to go to studio executives to ask permission or to get budgeting.
A visionary alliance. From the premise to the premiere. From the first draft to the last detail. From the first shot to the millionth cassette. Don Simpson and Jerry Bruckheimer are total filmmakers.
At the time, Simpson and Bruckheimer were asked, why are these advertisements being run in the New York Times? Why are they being run in the trade papers in USA Today? And Don Simpson and Jerry Bruckheimer said very bashfully, well, it was sort of embarrassing, but Paramount, in fact, insisted. Well, of course, it turned out later that Paramount had not insisted, had, in fact, resisted very strongly when Simpson and Bruckheimer asked them to run these ads, and had resisted strongly enough that Simpson and Bruckheimer ended up having to buy two of the ads themselves.
Gentlemen, this is the real thing. This is what you've been trained for.
You are America's best. Make us proud. Ice.
Yes, sir.
Hollywood.
Yes, sir.
Sector 2. And Maverick, you back him up with Merlin on Ready 5.
Yes, sir.
We are all slaves to the process of the movie itself. The movie is our mistress. We serve here. We serve her. The truth is, all of us are trying to ride the back of the monster known as the movie. We're trying to make sure everybody stays on, and we're trying to feed the monster at the same time.
My ideas about Top Gun were much darker, and I didn't really get a fix on what the concept of the movie was. It's a hardcore entertainment movie. It's a popcorn movie. And I was trying to do something much, much darker, much more serious, much closer to Apocalypse, you know. I was trying to push the tone of the performances and the actors and the situations into something which is much stranger and darker. In hindsight, I was wrong, and they were right. You know, they kept saying, no, it's a different tone, it's a different color, it's much lighter, yeah. It's an entertainment movie, it's not a message movie.
We gave him the opportunity here to lay in a little sequence where he could become a painter.
We also had some problems with it because there are moments in time like this shot, you can tell where the light is back here, where the light wasn't right, and Tony said, this is a nuclear-powered aircraft carrier, mind you. Tony says, well, let's turn the carrier around to get the sun in the other direction. And the Admiral says, that'd cost $150,000 and take a day. Tony said, so? Let's do it. We said, no, we're not doing that. I mean, let's turn the aircraft carrier around. At one point in time, they were actually going on war missions or something. They were war games.
Well, what happened was,
we were out there.
We negotiated with the Navy, and we finally got it down to $15,000, except we felt it was excessive and wouldn't pay for it. So Tony took out his own checkbook wrote a check to pay for this particular light.
He maybe got two shots for $15,000.
Although they have had famous directors work for them, all their films tend to look the same. They actually are producers who exert such extraordinary control. In fact, I suspect the more ideas and vision you have, the more difficult it would be to work for them.
You know, so I'm very tenacious and willful in a way. And I was warned by the studio, by Paramount, when we were shooting Top Gun, about Kelly McGillis and her makeup. They said her makeup was too strong and she was looking a little bit whorish, yeah? And that comes from my background, I think, in advertising in terms of lipstick and eyeshadow and pumps and steam stockings, yeah? And they kept warning me, and I just kept just pushing, trying to get really what I wanted, how I felt this character should be. And this particular day, I got a warning from Don and Jerry. They said, you've got to back off, and today you've got to back off, or otherwise you're in trouble, yeah? And this particular day, I didn't back off. I pursued. I thought I had just a little more rope, and I didn't. Yeah, and I got a call from the studio, and the studio said, unless you change your attitude or change the look of Kevin McGillis, you're in trouble and you could be off the picture. Yeah, so after that, I changed.
We knew we wanted a woman in this movie who was real. And again, contrary to what a lot of the esteemed critics had to say, this girl existed in every way, shape, and form. She was about 5'11", her name was Christine Fox, and she was a woman who had the very job that Kelly McGillis did in Top Gun. We were sitting in a room with an admiral, we told him we had a need, and we said, is there a woman like this in the environment? He pressed a buzzer.
The MiG-28 does have a problem with its inverted flight tanks. It won't do a negative G pushover.
He introduced us to her. She had a degree in astrophysics, and she had good legs.
The latest intelligence tells us that the most it will do is one negative. Excuse me, Lieutenant. Is there something wrong?
So she had lunch with me one day and said, where do you see your future? And I said, big deal, major deal. At a studio, and she said, so do I. Do you want to merge? And so we joined forces, and
we were yin and yang.
Yeah.
and the whole became larger than the sum of its parts.
Yeah, we've been partners.
We like to think. Well, watch one and hold it and roll the next one. Hi, it's Linda Obst calling. Is he there?
I'm not yet willing to give it up, you know? Okay, because I think it's a spectacular shot.
I'm appalled by Saul and this position that he's taking about the 3,000. I think he's dissembling in a major way, because I may be dumb, but I'm not so dumb as to make a deal that is contingent on going forward, where he only pays if we go forward, and he's in control of going forward. are, Vinky. This is why I called you. Thank you so much, and I'll talk to you soon. Bye. Carmen, can I have my lawyer?
Linda Obst is a producer. She used to be a journalist. She was involved in reporting on the Columbia Pictures scandal. She was the editor of a piece about that that ran in the New York Times. She ironically ends up as a producer at Columbia Pictures years later. Debra Hill is regarded as a very solid, dependable line producer. She gets a picture done. She runs the trains. She did a lot of work for Disney on films for their theme park in Florida, and in gratitude, Jeffrey Katzenberg, the chairman of the Disney Studios, sent her a baby grand piano. The funny thing about these two is that they haven't actually had what anyone would call an enormous commercial success, but they have had this ability to get pictures made, which counts for a lot. Just navigating through the shoals of Hollywood is a big skill.
Fisher King is a story about a DJ radio talk show host, and one night he's just feels terribly sorry for himself, and he goes out ready to commit suicide. He walks the Manhattan Bridge, and just as he was about to jump, he's suddenly saved by this sort of band of homeless people, who was sort of led by Perry or Robin Williams.
And how, in unexpectedly coming together, they find through each other salvation. The meaning of grace, friendship, and true love.
I laughed. I cried. I had to go on an errand, and I wouldn't stop reading the script. I was driving in the car with the script on my lap. I couldn't stop it. I thought, this is unbelievable. And I had to find the agent. It was a Sunday. I had to find the agent because the possibility that this script would not be made by us was unacceptable.
And we set it up at TriStar within a day, I guess.
24 hours.
Yeah.
And everybody in town wanted it.
So,
but we wanted to give it to the person that wanted it the most. This piece has it sometimes it feels protected to us. It always finds its home. It finds its proper director.
People who love it, we say, are in the cult.
Are in the cult.
Debra and Linda and Steve Randall, who is the executive at TriStar, flew over to London to have dinner. And they just told me how wonderful everything was going to be, how terrific I was, and I got drunk and bought their lies.
But the truth is, when we first said Terry Gilliam, there is a bit of bracing. There is a bit of bracing with sort of hands on chairs and white knuckles. You take a look at two women, and a certain sexist thing must come up. Do you know, how are these two women going to handle this terribly powerful, charismatic genius of a man? And they don't know these two women.
The producers of Munchausen, here's our list. The producer is Thomas Schuele. He, along with the executive producers and myself, had the job of going out and raising the money. And below that comes the line producer, who really deals with the day-to-day business of making the film. Supervising producer was a person who was put onto the film when it went out of control by the completion guarantors. The co-producers worked as an intermediary between me and the producer when that all fell apart, when I stopped talking to the producer just before we started shooting. Executive in charge of production was brought on to basically line produce the film. Production executive we have, but she was put on the film originally by Lloyd's of London, who were at that point producing the film, and she was their hit person. Had the production been properly controlled from the beginning, half those people wouldn't have been needed. They were brought on to keep, you know, throwing them into the line of fire, these people, to try to stop what was going on. Well, I decided to come to Hollywood at this particular point in my life because Munchausen went way out of control, and I And my reputation was of a guy who makes films that go out of control. I mean, it had nothing to do with my real reputation, which was before Munchausen, the guy who can make films look very expensive for very little money. But your reputation changes film by film. And when this script arrived, and it was a simple script, and it was really nice, I thought, this is a chance to actually go right into the mouth of the lion and prove to them, right in front of them, right where they can see it, where there's nothing up my sleeves, nothing, that we can make films under budget. So that's what I'm doing.
He has created lots of problems and lots of things, and he wants himself to be redeemed, which is the reason why I think he looks at Linda and I, as we're strong producers, with a real point of view, and he wants to come in on budget. He wants to create a mainstream Hollywood movie. Take my breath away.
He's exceedingly multifaceted. It's sometimes not readily apparent, but Jerry is the master of detail, and he is also uncommonly smart about what it requires to get someone to do something. I don't think I've ever met, let alone worked with anybody who has a greater capacity for infinite patience and perception when it comes to going from point A to point Z, because if he decides he's going to, he will. Not only that, he has, not unlike what Scott Fitzgerald said, the ability to hold the entire equation of movie making within his mind at one time. I haven't met anybody else who can do that. As a filmmaker, Jerry's the total filmmaker.
Well, Don is a very intelligent, very, very smart. He has almost a photographic, if not a photographic, memory. And he's a real big picture guy. He's always looking for the entire scope of things rather than the details, which I tend to go toward. And when we produce a picture, we're consumed in the entire operation of it.
I was taken to the movies for the first time when I was, I don't know, 4, 5, 6 years old. I saw a movie called The Greatest Show on Earth. And in that picture, Jimmy Stewart plays a clown who's running from the law. He's in the circus. He hides behind his clown makeup to hide his identity. He's accidentally murdered someone. His best friend falls from a trapeze wire, and he has to reveal himself as a doctor in order to save this man's life. And he goes to prison for the rest of his life. I was with my mother, and I said, I won't leave the theater. I won't leave unless you get them to change the end of the movie. I was convinced that was real. I absolutely believed it. After they spanked me and threw me out, it was rather evident that I'd been living in a fantasy world, but Jerry has accused me, and rightly so, of spending the rest of my career trying to change the ending of The Greatest Show on Earth.
Are still dangerous. You can be my wingman anytime.
Bullshit. You can be mine.
Addicted to sex, to cheeseburgers, I mean, all of which I plead guilty to. And I was and am addicted to movies. I love movies passionately. There was a point in time where, in fact, I had to stop going to movies for about a year because what occurred in that darkened room on that big screen was more real to me than life itself.
This is the real thing. This is the first thing in Top Gun where these guys are going up to deal with absolute reality in terms of the enemy. This is all absolute reality. Everything about this, there's no stage work here. All done absolutely real.
And this is where we got the reality.
What we did is we added the real thing element here.
Not to do anything. I was going to make a Woody Allen-style film. I was going to make little film, people just walking down the streets. Well, unfortunately, I've discovered I can't do that. And the thing starts growing. It just starts growing as I'm going around. For instance,
1,000 extras waltzing on command in Grand Central Station. And not just waltzing, but waltzing on command in a Grand Central Station that has been transformed into someone's hallucination. Filled with smoke, with a mirror ball revolving and xenon lights hitting it, and 3 camera positions, and 8 ADs, and 50 production assistants, all supposedly working in concert. That was one.
Just wanted to stand there and watch rush hour develop at Grand Central Station, watching the swarm, people begin to move faster, more of them, and it really is like the swarm. And I thought, this is amazing. And I said, at one point, I said, Jesus, what would be wonderful is if at one precise moment, all of these 1,000 people who are swarming madly past each other suddenly coupled up and started to waltz. And it was just a little thing that came to me as we were standing at Grand Central Station, and that's now in the script.
Started to see Terry take the script and make it his own. And the whole script started to take on a tone and a color that was Terry's at that moment. So you want to give him that set piece. That's what it is to be a producer, but you want to find a cost-effective way that your set piece isn't sinking your schedule and your budget.
The problem with a film, once it's gone out of control, once the basic structure and plan for the making of the film has gone, and it's a big film, say like Munchausen, with effects and huge locations, you can't stop it. You can then just try to somehow control this hurtling juggernaut that's going for the precipice. You keep extending the precipice. Basically, you're building out as fast as this thing is moving, and eventually the structure collapses and the whole thing falls into the abyss.
Baron Munchausen, so far as I can see, was kind of the classic runaway film. It's in some ways the film that Hollywood executives dread more than any other, because it's the one that got out there and started shooting and just kept shooting and shooting and shooting. You get into week 13, realize that it's cost you $20, $25 million, and there's no real turning back. What do? You turn around and write off the 20 to 25 million, or do you spend the next 13 to bring back the first 20 to 25? That's the decision that people dread more than anything else.
Now!
With Terry Gilliam, all kinds of red lights and sirens are going off. They're going to fight very hard, and in this case, they ended up at a figure just above $20 million. A lot of that money goes to pay Robin Williams, to pay Jeff Bridges. That's more millions. To pay Terry Gilliam, that's at least another $1.5 million. To pay Linda and Debra, another couple million maybe. So what you have is a budget just over $20 million, and probably a third to a half is just paying what they call above the line, paying the talent. The actual money that's going to go into what you see on the screen is going to be somewhere between 10 and 15.
Okay. We have what?
We have a costumery budget coming in a few minutes.
Oh, great.
And then what we have to do is review these questions creatively with Terry when the budget comes in, because my cuts were based on questions in those areas. They have 4 suits that I reduced to 2 suits that we can use in pieces.
We definitely need to have the raincoat hair on camera. I mean, we actually created a scene there.
Also, they had him scheduled to wear a new Versace-type suit to go back to Anne's, and I feel that creatively that's not necessary. If he goes in black jeans, a nice white shirt, and he just looks gorgeous. He doesn't have to get dressed up in his Versace
when he goes
to
back
go
to Anne
to
after
make up,
to, make
to
up.
Tell her he loves her. We have to look at that, because they had 4 major $2,000 suits budgeted.
We're in trouble here. We've made cuts. We still haven't got to the figure they're looking for. It's like any sort of bargaining. And then they've got to decide whether it's worth going ahead. Now, in a situation like this, it seems to me it's absolutely essential that one goes ahead, and of course it will, because you've got two major actors which are costing you over $8 million who are pay or play with 4 weeks to go before shooting. What do? Do you stop and pay off that money, or do you get on, bite the bullet, and make the film? The realities of Hollywood are we're going to make the film. Because Hollywood's a totally fluid place. It's everything is flexible, everything is movable, everything is changeable.
It was high diddle diddle. It was cat in the fiddle.
It's a strange game. I think I'm kind of enjoying learning it at first hand. Take off with the
Simpson and Bruckheimer are probably perceived at this point as the ultimate Hollywood, bad kids. They're the hot producers. They're the producers who sort of race around too fast all the time in their hot little cars and the adrenaline-driven producers of the huge movie.
Don had this idea book, and I was thumbing through it. He's this enormous, thick thing that he had dreamt up over his travels through Hollywood when he came to this town. He started just logging ideas of movies that he wanted to see. And I was flipping through it one weekend, and I came across Beverly Hills Cop. I said, God, what a great movie this would be. Well, I got pulled over in Beverly Hills, and I got pulled over. It became clear to me after the fact for no apparent reason. And what the cop told me was, well, the reason I pulled you over is you don't look like you belong here. And I was stunned. I said, what do you mean I don't belong here? I'm an American citizen. He said, yeah, but this is Beverly Hills. Basically, he thought I was a drug dealer or something. And it became clear to me that Beverly Hills was this enclave of privilege. And in my mind, as I started thinking about it, I said, wouldn't it be great if you took this hemisphere of crystal and you turned it upside down and saw what crawled underneath it? And the next phase of me thinking about it was, well, what would it take to probe this environment?
Don't you think I realize what's going on here, miss? Who do you think I am, huh? Don't you think I know that if I was some hot shot from out of town that pulled inside here and you guys made a reservation mistake, I'd be the first one to get a room and I'd be upstairs relaxing right now. But I'm not some hot shot from out of town. I'm a small reporter from Rolling Stone magazine that's in town to do an exclusive interview with Michael Jackson that's going to be picked up by every major magazine in the country. I was going to call the article, Michael Jackson is sitting on top of the world, but now I think I might as well just call it, Michael Jackson can sit on top of the world just as long as he doesn't sit in the Beverly Palm Hotel because there's no niggers allowed in there.
And excuse me, sir, it seems that we do have a last-minute cancellation. There is a room available. It's a suite, but I'll only charge you the single room rate.
Thank you. I'm sorry I got upset. It's probably from jet lag or something. I'm very tired.
I understand,
What's
sir.
The rate, anyway?
That'll be $235 a night, sir.
Fine.
Maverick, we're hit again!
It's okay. All systems are functioning. We're okay.
Heist. On the count of three, brake hard right.
Now, again, this is, we have nothing new. There's a thing in movie making. It's called mirrors. When you foreshadow an event early on in a movie, and then you establish the event, you try and mirror it sometime later. As a matter of fact, Chekhov had this notion that if you've got a rifle in the second act, you better go off and kill somebody in the third act.
What really started Top Gun was Don and I, at this point, had made, I guess, Flashdance together. And we had separate offices here on the Paramount lot. I walked over to his office, and as usual, he has about 100 magazines, current magazines, sitting in his outer office. He was on the phone, and so I'm thumbing through all these different magazines, and I hit this amazing photograph, and a thing called Top Guns. And I look at this thing, and I walk in his office, and as I'm reading it, I flip it upside down on his desk as he's talking and carrying on, and he looks at this thing, and his eyes, like, get enormous. And he hangs up the phone, he speed reads the thing, we gotta get this, we gotta buy this. And so he calls our development girl in, and she comes running in the office, she says, get on the phone with California Magazine, we want this right away. And that's how it started. That was the first thing that happened on Top Gun.
Let me correct one element first. While he was still looking at the magazine right side up. I was reading it upside down because I noticed how transfixed he was. And I was kind of not paying total attention to my phone call. And I started reading the article upside down, which is why he turned it around, because he saw I was doing that.
An executive trait. They learned this. It's executive training. You got to read your boss's mail on the desk upside
down.
That's
true. It's a tool of the executive warrior trade. You learn to steal information from wherever you can. What grabbed me was the colorful incidents, anecdotes, and characters. These guys had names like Hollywood.
Hollywood, we're losing Viper. Let's just stay on Jester.
Yogi and Possum.
I mean, they were all animals and characters, and this was true.
And holy shit, it's Maverick and Goose.
And there was terminology. I mean, both of us are terminology freaks.
I've got my eye on the Northern Bogey.
All this process and detail is magical when it comes to drama. It's the stuff that dreams are made of, in particular when it's real. One of the head admirals said, well, tell us about the movie you're going to make. I said, well, we're going to make a movie about the Top Gun school. He says, no, tell me the story. I looked at Jerry, and basically what I did is I stood up and started walking around the room, and I told him about the spirit of the movie. Which means, gentlemen, we are going to make a movie about the process of becoming a Top Gun. And we are going to dramatically expose you to what it's like to go through the process and succeed at it, and the price you have to pay to be, frankly, the most important warrior we have.
Woo! Rock and roll!
The significance of Top Gun is that it cemented for them a reputation for being able to take huge sums of money and huge canvases and turn them into successful motion pictures. This is the movie that made it possible for them to spend something like $100 million of Paramount's money on Days of Thunder.
Oh,
the biggest cheer in the movie.
Ooh, splash four!
Yeah!
Rain.
The first couple of days of shooting were rain.
A lot of rain, awful rain.
The rain.
But in the rain, production-wise, the big surprise has been the rain. Except that the rain was just torrential.
The rain.
When the New Yorkers get upset, they call the fire department. And the fire department thinks that they're answering a real call, so they come down, you know, with the, you know, engines blazing and everything going, and they actually think they're answering a real call. And what it does is it stops filming. And on our second day of filming, we were shut down for nearly an hour and a half because of that false alarm. Because we need to have the Red Knight in a fantasy run on horseback, gallop across the street, and we cannot close enough lanes on Madison Avenue to do that, we've moved the ostensible location of this armory to Fifth Avenue so we can shoot the horse sequence, which has to be tied into this on Fifth Avenue. But Fifth Avenue goes downtown, and Madison Avenue goes uptown. So every time we grab a shot, we have to stop traffic and move our cars, our company cars, in the downtown direction, which to your average New Yorker is a bit of a heresy.
Terry is, I suppose in one way, you would think a production manager's nightmare, insofar as what he considers normal is what almost anyone else would consider monumental on the highest levels that there could be. You just hold on 1 second. I've just got to get this. Hello? Yeah. Larry, can I call you right back? Pardon me, Larry?
It's big, it's huge, and the scope is grand. I think that this is going to be a different film than, a different view of New York than it's been seen before in any other film. Is that it?
Call you right back. Sorry.
We're approximately a day and a half behind schedule starting our third week. And I don't think we're going to be able to catch up. Probably, we may pull some scenes to Los Angeles, but we'll never fully catch up.
Well, we're a teeny bit behind, but I think all things being equal, we're as on schedule as we had expected to be, apart from the rain.
We've been doing a lot of rethinking since we've fallen behind, and I think the word of the day is simplify.
Cut! Terrific!
This week's cost report, I see it shows an increase of $249,811. Pushes us up over $1.6 million now.
And then we had extras too that day.
$10,000 savings that we have in props, we were going to augment.
I moved that.
For a total of $246,794, mm-hmm. basically unapproved overages, and then an additional $3,000 for car for Robin Williams.
We are over budget.
We're approximately 9 days behind schedule at the moment.
Besides this concern with the finances is going, wait a second, you said you were going to, we wanted to do it for 20, then you got us up to 23, and now you can't even do it for 23. Now you're at 24 and maybe more, 24.5, and where are you going and what the hell's happening?
And additional problems would be then just the miscalculation of what Terry wanted to achieve his vision.
Debra has to go back to the people at TriStar and say, hey, we have a good picture here, but it's going to cost so much more money. And they're going to go, what are you, you know.
The studio's been terrific. I think that when we signed off on the budget, we signed off at around 23.5, something like that. And they had, like in a cookie jar, $1.5 million, which they anticipated us to be over. And they just don't want us to go over any further. I mean, now it's getting really serious.
Hold on a minute. Don't you think we ought to talk?
What, about how I'm going to run? Sure.
About how you've managed to live as long as you have.
What you see in the background are what's left of 50 cars we had built. This is towards the end of our schedule, and right now that's it. And every one of those cars that you're looking at down there are cars that have been completely rebuilt because we've crashed them all. So far we've crashed about 65 cars, these are the only ones that are running today.
It's certainly true that Simpson and Bruckheimer, who are both fitness freaks and health nuts, had a certain number of hotel rooms turned into a certain smaller number of hotel rooms. I heard at one point they turned 5 rooms into 1. They turned 3 rooms into 2. I'm not sure what happened in the end, but again, it was an example of what, from the outside, was seen as wild overspending.
I was desperate to get your attention.
Jerry and I have made a career out of making lower-budget pictures without stars. That includes Beverly Hills Cop. Eddie Murphy made one movie before that, and the picture cost $9 million. Top Gun, which cost $14 million, and Tom Cruise had made one little movie that was called Risky Business. That's the sort of movies we made. We did make a picture in our career this summer called Days of Thunder that cost a lot of money.
Well, I'm going to let you in on a little secret that almost everybody else in this world automatically knows. Control is an illusion, you infantile egomaniac.
Days of Thunder did not fare very well at the box office, and there are a lot of differing theories on why that was. It was rushed, it was hurried into production, it didn't have the post-production time that it needed. As a result, it felt choppy, it felt confused, and it was about car racing. No one has ever made a successful movie about car racing in this country.
I can't tell you how much we all appreciate you letting us use the car, Rowdy.
I told you about this, Rowdy. Harry's got some new driver and he needs a car just to turn a couple of laps. I told you it was Harry Hogg that asked us personally as a favor.
Who is this driver?
Hmm.
Days of Thunder, I really did feel cheated in terms of the end product, the end movie, because the movie was from the point that Robert Towne hit the keys on the typewriter to the day it was released. It was 8 months, and that is insufficient time to, you know, to do a movie like that and spend that amount of money. And I felt the end product suffered. Consequently, it suffered because there's not enough attention to the script in the early stages. And in the end, people run, you know, they run back to formulas and things you've actually done before. You go back to a shorthand that you know has worked in the past, and that's just insane trying to edit a movie in 22 days.
Simpson and Bruckheimer have liked to describe themselves as auteur producers. This is a phrase that I think they probably use those very words or something close to them in interviews repeatedly. They have told people that when we produce a movie, it's very nearly as if we were directing a movie. In order to make movies that way, you find almost no escape hatch from the responsibility. Also, I think that these guys, because they made such a visible point of putting their personal stamp on the film from beginning to end, called a lot of their woes this year down on their own heads.
There was a considerable amount of envy around Hollywood, particularly at Paramount, when the deal was announced. A lot of producers started saying, well, I don't have that kind of deal. Why don't I get that? I can't spend everybody's money without having to ask anybody about it. Why don't I get that?
The deal's over. How do we feel about it? It was a great deal.
Don Simpson told me the day after the news leaked out about the breakup of the relationship with Paramount that this was the best day he had had since the day Top Gun was released.
It was a great deal, but it's over.
It's over.
How do you feel about that?
We're really looking forward to new horizons. We're looking forward to working in a new environment, and an environment that is appropriately conducive to support of our abilities.
The relationship had stopped working largely because Paramount was changing its attitude about what kind of pictures it wanted to make. It apparently decided that it could not afford to make the large event pictures once every 3 years or 4 years that Simpson and Bruckheimer liked to make.
There's nothing I can't do with a race car.
Clearly they have seen that this year has been typified by smaller budget movies surprising people by earning a lot of money. The two biggest pictures of the year are Ghost and Pretty Woman. Those two together cost less than half of what Days of Thunder cost.
There were two pictures that almost destroyed Hollywood. There was a picture called Easy Rider, which was a wonderful success. There was another picture called The Sound of Music. Now, these two pictures, Hollywood decided that that was the wave of the future, just like Ghost is now. So they went out and made a lot of youth movies that cost very little money. Not one of them succeeded. They went out and made five $20 million pictures because Sound of Music was a big award, Academy Award winning movie, made a ton of money. And so they made Star and Dr. Doolittle, and they felt they had the mold for the future. Every single picture failed. So nobody knows what's coming. And if they start making a bunch of Ghosts, guess what? They're going to fail too. Ghost, which was a very effective movie for that moment in time, and a very good movie, was surrounded by a lot of other movies that helped it pop out of the box, and there was a need for that picture. Who knows what's going to happen next summer or this Christmas or what's coming up next? Nobody knows.
And I think one of the reasons that we're able to make this movie now as a mainstream movie, even though it's very black in many ways and very unusual, is because the market itself is sophisticating and changing. And I think right now we're at the cusp of the greatest change in sensibility that this market has gone through since I've been in this business, and Debra's been in this business for, 10, 15 years. It's a much more adult movie market. All bets are off.
Britain has become one of the playgrounds of the world. For in these islands, there's joy and variety for every kind of taste.
The good news is that we're back on budget. We were able to save some money in post-production as Terry gained more and more confidence about the performances of the actors and the script and all of that as it was cut together. We cut out a number of special effects shots, and so we're back right on budget. I think the studio was so happy that we finished that, you know. We are on budget. He's happy. I mean, when you think of some of the other films that are coming in, like, for instance, Bonfire of the Vanities and Hudson Hawk and Billy Bathgate and all these other big films which are really going terribly awry, I mean, Terry really, I think, is going to be redeemed with this picture. I mean, obviously, it's going to depend on what it does in the marketplace, but we really brought this picture in for $12.5 million below the line, and that's quite a unique performance on his part, I think.
And yours.
Thank you.
Also, I think that the fact that this is how you can tell in Hollywood that someone's been redeemed, not that he needed to be redeemed, but went back on everybody's A-list, as it were. Last week, I got three phone calls from other producers asking if Terry would be interested in a comedy like A or a comedy like B, and I had to chuckle.
It's the kind of thing as a filmmaker that is the ultimate reward when you see the audience having and sharing the emotion that you experienced during the making of the movie. That's what it's all about.
And that's, you go through all the pain and all the tribulations of making films, and when you have this one moment where those chills go up your spine, it's all worth it.
Yeah, it's really us living the lives of the characters there on the deck.
With the audience.
That's it.